Welcome back to Weekend. Still to come this Sunday morning, actress and good laugh Tameka Empson, who plays Kim Fox in Albert Square. She'll be joining me. Never a dull moment when she's around. But now I want you to cast your minds back to 2009. My next guest was a 19-year-old single mother from Dagenham who wowed the X Factor judges with her unique version of What a Wonderful World and went on to book her place in the final of the show. Since then, she hasn't stopped working on television. I'm delighted to say she's back doing the singing and has just released her debut album, Shy. To tell us all about it, it's Stacey Solomon.
Nice to see you too.
Hey, congratulations.
It's cozy.
It is. Congratulations on the album.
Thank you.
It's been a long time coming.
It has, but I'm so proud of it, and we've worked really hard, and I've been lucky enough to do some unbelievable things whilst working hard on the album, so...
I've got to say, there's a version of the Coldplay Embrace song, Gravity, on it.
That's beautiful. Oh, thank you
so much. Your voice is so stunning. How did you feel when you had it in your hands for the first time?
I remember feeling like, I don't want anyone to see it. I don't know why, I just felt, I was so proud, and I couldn't believe... I mean, just making my own music video and then seeing the cover and the pictures, and I wrote, like, little credits at the end and reading them, it was amazing. But I remember feeling really protective over it and being like, get away. I was like, Gollum.
did you play it to your family? Because I know you're part of a massive family.
I am, and you can imagine how excited they were. The anticipation for this for them has just been incredible. And as soon as I sort of took it home, I kept it quiet for a little while. It was only when my dad rang me up like a few days later and said, nice album, by the way. I stole it and put it on my laptop without you knowing. I know. God, copyright.
But it seems so odd that it's taken the 6 years for you to bring it out, because you went on X Factor to do the music.
Yes.
And your success on X Factor meant that you didn't do the music, you did everything else.
I really wanted to write my own music and be involved in an album like I'd always dreamed of. And to do that, it just meant I had to wait a little bit longer to get that kind of contract where the label would allow me to do what I wanted to do. And so I did. And I was so lucky that in between I was offered all kinds of amazing jobs and new experiences. So I kind of took those on whilst I was waiting for the right album deal to come along.
How much of your past life do you go back on when you're writing?
I think writing is just such a strange experience. One, I feel like whatever it is that I'm feeling at the time, whatever I walk into the studio with on my shoulders is what I end up writing about.
Right.
And then I feel like I've been to therapy for a whole day.
Well, lots of singer-songwriters say the same thing.
I come
thing.
Out just so, I don't know, relieved. And
is it the words that you... that? Inspire you, or the music, or...?
A bit of both, really. So a lot of the time... I mean, most of the time, the words reflect the music, obviously. Mm. And then, a lot of the time, it starts off with music before I even think of a concept or what it's about.
Okay.
But the music, the mood of the music always comes from however I'm feeling as I walk into the studio.
Do you play it without knowing?
Yeah, piano, guitar, and then we have different sessionists who come in and we just mess around, and it's so much fun. Mm. The process is incredible.
Do you listen to a lot of music, Martin?
Yeah.
Do you play anything?
Well, I mean, very badly. I can play a keyboard a bit and play the guitar a little bit.
But... we can make our own band.
Yeah, all right, let's do that. Yeah, there you go.
That's the best offer you've had today so far, isn't
definitely.
It?
Definitely. And you can manage it.
Oh, lovely. It's 25% if that's all right.
Oh, that's a bit of steep.
Sorry.
Blimey.
It's not bad for the music industry.
You know, all of this almost didn't happen, you know, the dream that you're living now, if you like. You were very young when you became a parent to start with. It meant that you didn't go to college. You ended up working in the chip shop, didn't you?
I did go to college. I went to college and had a young child and worked in the chip shop
Amazing.
At the same time. I mean, I was excited to do that. I knew that I wanted to follow my dreams, and I was always really ambitious, and nothing was going to stop me.
That chip shop was called Oh My Cod.
Yeah, it was actually the best job ever. I got to, like, I'm so sociable and I love meeting people, and, you know, you get your regulars on a Friday. Two cod, one chips. I loved it.
I can see a series coming on here. It's brilliant, absolutely. Also, I would say, seriously now, that yours is the story and an inspiration for people as well. You know, that if at first you don't succeed, try again, because that's exactly what you did with The X Factor.
Oh, yeah, I auditioned 3 times before I got into The X Factor, and I never felt disheartened after any of the auditions. I'm kind of one of those people that's just like, oh, okay, next year. I really want to indent that into my children as well, that anything's possible. It really is, and if you try as hard as you can achieve all of your dreams.
And you did. Are you in touch with any of the old X Factor lot?
Yeah, I speak to Ollie, Joe, Lucy, everyone all the time. It was such a great year, actually. Really good year.
It led to so many other TV opportunities. Queen of the Jungle, of course. And we've seen you recently on The Jump. You must like a challenge.
Oh, you know me. I do like to be challenged, and there is something about sort of like extreme sports and doing crazy things that most people think I couldn't do, but I love that.
Yeah.
I remember when they asked me to do The Jungle, and I told my family, and they were like, yeah, right. See you in a week, Stace. There's just no way. And I was like, inside, that just made me feel like I have to do this.
Yeah. But that's the side people don't maybe see of you very often, but you've got that in you, haven't you? That tough grit, if you like.
I feel so lucky all the time to get the opportunities to do these things, let alone actually give them a go and try my hardest to do it. I don't think I could ever pass up on it.
And The Jump got your boyfriend.
It did.
And he's here with you, Steve-O from Jackass. Is a night out with him pretty dangerous?
Well, he's teetotal, so it's nice.
And we know you're not, because is the drink still Malibu and pineapple?
You know, I love a Malibu and pineapple. It's like such a baby's drink, but alcohol tastes disgusting, if you ask me. And the only thing that tastes nice is Malibu and pineapple, don't you agree?
I wouldn't know.
Vodka's disgusting. Wine. Beer. Who invented beer? It's terrible.
Yeah.
Everybody. It's terrible.
Well, listen, I'm so thrilled that you're back doing the day job. I'm just so happy for you as well, you know, because I know that singing and performing is the first love, so you're back doing what you love most. And you're going to perform for us, aren't you?
Yes!
Go and get yourself ready.
Thank you. You've
got the band there with you as well. Brilliant musicians. So, with the title track from her brand new album, Shy, co-written by Rita Ora, it's Stacey Solomon.
You gave me those butterflies the minute I caught your stare. The room was electrified and we were both standing there. The feeling was so intense, my heart, it was beating fast. I sent you a little prayer to not let this moment pass, 'cause you'll never know if you try. Something so sweet could be passing us by. I could be yours and you could be mine. Why do you have to go and make me so shy? Past. The whole world is at your feet. My confidence fading fast. I'm drowning in words I can't speak. I wonder if you are real. I want you to come to me. All the colors blurring into one, just like a star so beautiful but impossible to reach. 'Cause you'll never know if you try. Something so sweet could be passing us by. I could be yours and you could be mine. But why do you have to go and make me so shy? I'm playing me so cruel. I never thought I'd be somebody else's fool. But damn, don't you understand? 'Cause you'll never know if you never try. Something so sweet could be passing us by. And you could be mine.
to go and make me so shy.
To Stacey, and there'll be more from Stacey and the band a little later. Very excited for that. Still to come this Sunday, I'll be joined by two wonderful actresses, the ever-bubbly Tameka Empson, Kim in EastEnders, and the legendary Glynis Barber, who's currently in one of the West End's biggest musicals. Plenty to stick around for. See you shortly. Welcome back to Weekend with Martin Shaw and Stacey Solomon, who's got another song for us at the end of the show. Now then, there aren't many laughs to be had in EastEnders, to be honest, are there? But when they do come, it's usually thanks to my next guest. She's a very versatile actress who can do it all, the straight heavy stuff and the comedy too, and that's just in Albert Square. I loved her in her previous incarnation as one of the three non-blondes. Please welcome the lovely Tameka Empson.
Honey,
oh. I'm good, how are you?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
I'm better now. Please.
What I love about Tameka, she's not dramatic at all.
Dramatic? No. I love this.
Thank you very much.
I love it.
Thank you. Well, you're welcome back whenever you want to come.
Thank you.
6 years in EastEnders now.
Yeah.
And it hasn't been a dull moment.
No, not really. Well, there have been, but I haven't been involved.
No.
Involved.
You're like, I suppose, a ray of sunshine. Let's have a look.
How are we ever going to get out of this mess? Oh, hang on. Look, we've been through worse. Kim, we owe thousands here.
Listen to me. It's going to take more than a few bills to get us girls down. You're gonna dry your eyes and you're gonna kill it at this interview. And I'm gonna put on my best dress and go down to the job centre. Yes, I know. But I'm not gonna leave without something. And together, we're gonna work this out. All right? Because the Fox sisters are against the world.
I was going to say, no acting required there, because that's exactly how you just walked onto this set.
Well, you know, it's a bit of Kim and me, you know. I think we've just moulded into each other. Kim, Tameka, Tameka, Kim.
She made such a massive impact. The clothes, the voice, the behaviour.
Yes, yes, and the walk. People have come up to me with the walk as a sachet.
Yeah, so it's a good walk.
Yeah, she's sachet. She doesn't walk, she's sachet.
And I should say, congratulations. You're the fifth actress to give birth on a live episode of a soap.
Thank you.
Did you know that?
I do now. Thank you. I knew it was live.
Before
yes.
you, there was Fizz in Corrie, there was Lola in EastEnders, and there was Debbie and Jean Dingle in Emmerdale as well.
Yeah.
And then you.
Yeah, we're doing it for the mothers. We're doing it for the mothers.
What was it like?
Oh. Well, it was quite challenging because, you know, it was in the toilets of the Vic. And when they told me, I thought, oh, you're joking, aren't you? And they said, no. I said, no, really? But it was really good. It was really good with Diane and Louisa and Sonia.
But the whole live episode thing, how nerve-wracking was that? Because I know you come from a stage background as well.
Yeah.
And so it's no biggie for you, isn't it? Because you're used to doing live stage work anyway.
Well, this is it, because, you know, we're in the close set and Louisa was a bit, you know, you're going to be okay, you know, get all the energy going. And for me, I just wanted to just go into a zone and just keep very calm because there's a lot of screaming that I had to do. So I just went back to, like you say, theatre.
Now, this little comic bone of yours, it comes from your mum, doesn't it?
Yes, my mum is a very funny lady, but she's funny without realising it.
Okay.
I don't know why, but she is who she is, you know. So, in fact, I have a friend called Tracy that I used to go to school with, and her name is Tracy. She used to come over to my house and go on the computer, and she goes, oh, Sharon, tell your mum that you're staying for dinner. She goes, okay, Mrs. Empson. I said, yes. Sharon, do you want a drink? I said, Mrs. Empson, my name is Tracy. She goes, oh, okay. You look like a Sharon, so I'm going to call you Sharon. And her name was Sharon. That's it.
The way you got into this industry as well is a bit of a fluke, really, isn't it? A friend of yours was putting on a variety show and needed someone to sort of fill in a gap, and you and your mate got up on stage.
Yes, this was how we got into... or how I got into comedy, stand-up. And what had happened, a friend of ours was putting on a variety night, and a few of the cast members were late because there was some roadblock or something. So just before, my friend Jocelyn Giesin, who was one of the three non-blondes and myself, we just thought, OK, let's just muck about. So we put on these shoes and we had these characters called Dolores and Shirley. And we would just sing. We were just these old Motown crooners who just wanted to sing and show everybody our talent.
Do you remember what you used to do?
Yeah, we worked on a sketch and because they were bitter and out of work, they used to sing. So they got a job in a supermarket and they would say, "This aisle is for 5 items or less. Can't you read you?" And we would harmonise everything. It was just the very simple things. So they had a job at the supermarket.
And the three non-blondes, I loved it. It looked like you guys were just having such fun, you know, let out loose on the public.
Yes, we were let out loose. It's one of those things where, you know, you're with your friends and you have a little laugh. Oh, that's so funny. But then you think, will the public get it? You know, will that really transcend? But it worked.
Once you're in EastEnders, and we'll talk about this a little bit more because we've got Glynis coming on as well. Of course, she was in EastEnders for a couple of years as well. You're on that treadmill. It means you can't do the theatre, but you always managed to do the panto in Hackney.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. Really enjoyed it. And I love theatre because, OK, in the studio, you've got time to take it again, but when it's live, and I love the audience participation as well. You know, so
and of course, you're Olivier nominated in the theatre, for goodness sake.
Yes, Olivier nominated, yes, thank you.
We should have talked to you in a different way. And I should just, because we're running out of time, congratulations on being a mummy as well.
Oh, thank you, thank you. Hi, Nyla!
Hi, Nyla.
Where you are?
That was almost like a Duff Duff EastEnders moment then. We went, hi, Nyla, hi, Nyla.
Yeah.
Have you had one of those yet?
Yes, I have. I've got one coming up as well, so watch out. What is it about?
Listen, thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
You'll hang around, won't you?
Of course I will.
Excellent, good. And also, with Nyla, have you taken any film of her yet? Because she's only small, isn't she?
Yes,
do you film her every move?
Well, she's running around and it's just so hard to keep up with her. But yeah, I've got some little footage of her. You know.
The reason I ask is it's time to find which videos have been going viral this week, usually lots of baby ones. To take us through his favourite trending trio, please welcome back Iain Stirling.
Hello. Lovely to meet you. Really great.
Ah, it's a friendly catch. Kisses as well.
Yeah.
How are you?
Awesome. I'm all right. I've just dropped. I've been attacked.
Yeah, well, that's what happens when you have Tameka on the city. Haven't seen you for a while. You've been busy?
I have. I've been doing sort of a bit of stand-up. I filmed a panel show, but for a children's panel show.
Oh, OK.
Yeah, so it's like a Mock the Week sort of style, but the team captains are sort of 12-year-olds.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did you never hear the expression, never work with children? And
Well, yeah, I did hear that phrase, but then I've sort of needed the money, Alex.
What have you got for us?
The first clip I've got for you is selfie sticks.
They're
controversial. Do we love them?
No.
Do we hate them?
No. Over them.
Really?
Yeah, aren't you? Do you see everyone walking around London now? No one looks at the sights, they're just looking at this stick.
Well, I'll tell you what. We found out a new thing about selfie sticks. Mm-hmm. Health and safety nightmare.
Oh, really?
Yeah, as this man found out in Venice.
I love selfie sticks now.
I know, right. Yeah, there's that horrible moment where he gets his wallet out of his pocket and just gets these, like, damp euros and just shakes them about.
Oh, no, sorry.
So there you go. Health and safety nightmare on the old selfie sticks. This week, I feel like it's a real health and safety theme developing.
Oh, good. Well, we've had babies for a few weeks, so it's time to move on, maybe.
Well, in that case, party poppers. They're fine.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen the new big, massive ones?
No.
No.
Well, they're these new big, huge, huge party poppers. Great for a party, but you've got to use them correctly or you might get your fingers burned. Check this out.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Happy birthday! Don't point it at me or...
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Three, two, one.
I'm just taking it.
Ah! Oh, my God! What are you like?
Oh, dear.
The best of that clip, it reminds me of my childhood so much. Everyone is concerned for that child's health and health, apart from the father, who's just in the corner going, bah!
Serves you right.
Yeah, so there you go. They're fun, you've got to be careful.
Yes, kind of horrible exactly. Inevitability about it.
It was like one of those, it's like in a horror film where you can you can see it coming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Nightmare. Final clip.
Okay.
Alid.
Yes.
I've saved the best till last.
Oh, have you?
I don't say this lightly. This is maybe the greatest thing I have ever seen on the internet.
Okay.
We've got PS4s now. We've got Xbox Ones. Yeah. Kids are never off their iPads. But what we've got now is the greatest game ever invented. It includes pie, it includes your face, it includes numbers, it looks a little something like this.
Oh, no, me! One, two, three.
And do you know what I hate about the team that work on this show? My friends, so-called friends, they've managed to find the last one in the country.
I don't know how you got hold of one. They're impossible
they're
to buy.
They're impossible to get hold of, but they've managed it. So I thought you and I could have a little game.
I think we're going to go viral.
Do you reckon?
Let's do it.
Shall I go first?
Yeah.
So what you do is you spin this.
So you spin, that gets a number of turns.
Two.
Two. Right. So you've got two spins and it's forwards. Here we go. One. Two. Oh. Oh.
It's your go.
Okay.
God, I hope it goes on your face. Right, I'll spin for you.
Oh, yeah, I bet it's a four.
Four.
I thought it would be. And here we go.
Oh. Bet you wish you don't have a beard now.
Yeah, I know. One, two, three, four. Yes! Oh. Yes!
Are you sure you two don't want to play?
Go on.
No,
I'm all right.
I'm all right.
Right, come on then. I'll have a go.
Right, I'm going to spin for you.
Thank you very much. Oh, thanks, guys.
Here we go. Come on, five. 17. No, four. Four. One. Two, three.
Yes! Yes.
It was about to happen, wasn't it? Thank you very much, Iain.
And Alan, do you think my beard looks bad?
I think I should probably get cleaned up. After the break, I'll be joined by the one and only Glynis Barber. I hope she turns up. And Stacey Solomon will also be performing again for us live, a real classic. See you in a minute or two. Why me? Welcome back to Weekend with Martin Shaw, Tameka Empson and Stacey Solomon, who's performing for us again a little bit later. But my final guest of the day, like Martin here, has starred in many television and theatre shows. Her big break came in 1984 when she was cast as the female half of the cop duo Dempsey and Makepeace, of course. The series was a worldwide hit, shown in over 30 countries. She's gone on to star in top soaps, Emmerdale and, like Tameka, EastEnders 2, and is now on stage in the award-winning musical Beautiful. Please welcome to Weekend the gorgeous Glynis Barber. How are you?
Hello.
Very nice to see you.
Thank you.
And you all know each other, of course.
We do! Hi, honey!
Hello again.
Hi.
And if you ever
it's so lovely to see Martin.
Actors,
it's been ages.
Meet up, that's it.
We could have a party now. We're all old friends.
You two worked together on a film.
Yeah. We did. I don't know how long ago it was, but it was a very long time ago. The Hound of the Baskervilles.
A very long time ago.
Was it? And, of course, you two didn't work together, but you were in EastEnders at the same time.
Yeah.
But anyway, I came to see you last night in Beautiful. It's the Carole King story, of course.
Yes.
It's incredible. I can't believe it hasn't been done before now.
I know, with such incredible music, such an incredible story, and I mean, I was surprised when I read the script because I didn't know that Carole King was a major songwriter. I thought her life began at Tapestry, yeah. And
it certainly didn't.
No, it really, really didn't.
But that's what I love about it. You know, you sit there in the show. I don't know if either of you have seen it, and it's hit after hit, and everyone around me were going, "Oh, do you remember that one?" and singing along with it. It's such a great night at the theatre.
Yeah, thanks.
And you get a Carole King concert for free every night.
I do. Why do you think I did it? I was like the biggest Carole King fan ever.
Oh, you still like the songs then?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Tapestry is one of the first albums I ever bought.
Right.
And I was a huge, huge fan. And I've never been in a musical before because I don't sing. I'm the only person who doesn't sing. And they said, "Well, you know, how do you feel about this, you know, signing up for like 9 months?" I went, "I'm okay. I'm OK with that, listening to Carole King music."
But what I love about it, yes, in the actual musical, you don't sing until the end, but then you have a little boogie and a sing
song
in the
curtain
call, and I could see you going for it.
I actually lie. I do sing in the curtain call, and I sang with Carole King because she came to our first night. She came to our press night, and she surprised us. And she came on stage, and the entire cast burst into tears.
Of course.
As did the audience, so we were all just sobbing. And you know, she gave a little speech, and then she started singing "You've Got a Friend" with us, which I don't sing in the curtain call, so it's just as well I know every single word on the album so I could actually sing with her.
And it's 8 shows a week, of course, but that's no problem for you because you're fighting fit anyway all the time, aren't you? But you are very careful about what food you put in your body.
Well, I mean, health is an interest of mine, so, you know, I do other things relating to that as well.
You've got a book?
I've just brought out a book in the last week called The In Sync Diet, which I wrote with a nutritionist, so... yeah, and I do an anti-aging lifestyle website as well. Okay. So
because you're very careful about what you eat as well, aren't you?
Sure.
I remember that about you being very healthy. I wasn't healthy then, but I remember you being very healthy.
Interestingly, as well, you've got a very similar story when it comes to acting because you started very young, as we found out, 3 years old, and you got into the whole thing because you loved Hayley Mills and The Parent Trap from the age of 5 or something like that.
Well, yes. I mean, I don't come from a theatrical background at all, but when I grew up in South Africa, there was no television, and I never went to the theatre, so I didn't see any plays. But I think my two earliest films, one was Disney's Snow White, and the other one was The Parent Trap. And I just thought, well, that looks great. That really looks like fun. And I sort of got the bug.
And the first TV break was Blake 7, of course, wasn't it?
Yes, I suppose that would be it.
And I know that everyone talks to you about Dempsey and Makepeace. It's the same. Everyone talks to you about The Professionals. And I try not to. But what I was interested about was
that
Dempsey and Makepeace almost didn't happen. Because you were doing something else at the time, you were doing Jane.
Well, I'd done Jane, which was I think it was one of the first shows, if not the first show, that had a CGI background. Mm-hmm. So sort of real life people with a CGI background.
It was a wartime story, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was based on a strip cartoon in the Second World War. And we did series one, and we were due to do series two, and they wanted me to sign up, and Dempsey and Makepeace came along. And I had the interview and the recall, and then they said, right, we'll let you know by next week. And we said, well, you know, we've got to let Jane series two know, we'll be back to you. And they didn't come back. And my agent said, what should we do? And I said, well, sign up for Jane. Mm-hmm. So we did. And then Dempsey and Makepeace came back and went, what are you doing? We just saw it in the paper. So they actually had to postpone the series. I think they couldn't quite believe we'd done that.
Amazing. Good work on your behalf. Two wages.
Worse,
yeah,
know.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
let me ask you, after the first day of rehearsal, if I had you on the couch and we'd have this interview and I said, Michael Brandon, marrying material, what would you have said?
Oh, no. I would have thought, you know, completely mad. No, I didn't like the look of him. And then when I met him, he was very loud.
But
that won't do at all.
You've survived the test of time, though. You've been married for, what, 25 years now? What's the key to having a successful marriage in the public
eye? I have no idea, because I don't have one. But no, I'm joking. People ask that all the time.
Sorry.
As if I hold the key. I really don't know.
Well, what's your key, then, I suppose?
Well, I think if, you know, because every relationship has its ups and downs, and it's not easy living with someone. And I think we have different personalities, and I think some people, the moment there's a problem, they'll walk away from it and not stick it out. And I think Michael and I both have personalities that we don't do that. So we don't just walk out a relationship or give up, you know, when there's a problem. Mm-hmm. So I think that's worked in our favour, you know, that we're the kind of people who stick with something. And I would say humour.
Right.
You know, Michael is funny, and I do like a funny bloke.
And we mentioned EastEnders briefly. You could go back to it, of course, couldn't you?
Well, I could.
She
might. No, don't read anything into that.
No, but you know, you created quite a lot of havoc when you were there.
Yeah.
And lots of unfinished business.
Yes, I would say quite a lot of unfinished business.
Would you
business.
Go back?
It would be quite nice to go back and settle a few scores and...
Me?
I don't know why I'm looking at you.
I'm on your team.
You were on my team.
Yeah.
I see you do that face very well, and it's very scary, honestly.
You'd be all right with me, Ben.
Listen, good luck with the book, The Instinct Diet, and also good luck with the musical. I absolutely loved it, and I urge anyone to go and see it, because you leave that theatre on such a high. The songs just keep on coming, one after another. Thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Then, for last treat, with her version of the Dusty Springfield classic Son of a Preacher Man, that's a good song as well. Mm. There's one that Carole King didn't write. It's Stacey Solomon.
Billy Ray was a preacher's son, and when his daddy would be easy to come. When they gathered around and started talking, that's when Billy would take me walking. Out through the backyard we'd go walking. Then he'd look into my eyes. Lord knows to my surprise, the only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man. The only boy who could ever teach me was the son of a preacher man. Yes, he was. He was. Isn't always easy, no matter how hard I try. When he started sweet talking to me, he'd come and tell me everything is alright. He'd kiss and tell me everything is alright. Can I get away again tonight? The only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man. The only boy who could ever teach me was the son of a preacher man. Yes, he was. He was.
Big thank you to Stacey, and her album Shy is out now. Thank you.
Thanks, Helen.
And a big thanks to all my guests. Martin Shaw, who's starring in the new series of Inspector George Gently, Wednesdays at 8 p.m. on BBC One. Miss it at your peril. Tameka Empson, where we can see in EastEnders, of course, Monday next, 8 p.m. And Glynis Barber, who's currently on stage at the Aldwych Theatre London in the musical Beautiful. See you next Saturday and Sunday, when I'm joined by the hilarious Vic Reeves. The amazing singers Ray Morris and David Gray, Towie Sam Fares, and from Emmerdale, Natalie Anderson. What a lineup. That's 8:30 here next Saturday morning. See you then. Bye-bye for now.